Welcome to another episode of After School. I'm Dr. Sarah Hill, and today we're going to be talking about the brain on the birth control pill. How much do you know about the birth control pill? Like, really know about the birth control pill? Now, if you're a woman watching, you've probably heard the drill. You may have an increased risk of stroke or pulmonary embolism if you're on the pill, especially if you're over 35 and smoke. Or worse yet, there's the possibility of weight gain, which, despite the fact that most of us wouldn't like to admit this, can seem a lot more terrifying than the possibility of a stroke. And for the men watching, you also know a few things about the pill. For instance, you probably know that the pill prevents pregnancy. And if your partner is on the pill, that this can spare you from the cruel and unusual fate of having to wear a condom during sex. But how much do you know about the birth control pill when it comes to the part of our bodies that most of us care about more than any other? What do we know about the birth control pill when it comes to the brain? Now, asking this question is something that feels a little risky to a lot of women. And this is because to ask this question violates two rules of feminism that most of us have unconsciously adopted since childhood. The first of these rules is that we should not criticize the birth control pill. Women are, understandably, very protective of the pill. And the reason for this is that it's been absolutely amazing for women. And just to illustrate this for you, here is the proportion of female applicants to law and medical schools in 1970, 2 years prior to the birth control pill being made legally available to single women. Women made up just 10% of the applicant pool. Flash forward 20 years later to 1990, when the birth control pill is readily available to single women, and this number has grown considerably. Women became 40% of the applicant pool. And now, women are the majority. Giving women access to safe, effective contraception, rather than making us risky and irresponsible, as some have argued that it would, it has allowed us to dream bigger and do more than even the most optimistic feminist would have ever imagined 100 years ago. Giving women the ability to regulate their fertility has allowed us to plan. When women are able to plan, they use this freedom to learn, grow, and achieve. Women are protective of the birth control pill because it has been one of the most important advancements in terms of allowing women to become politically and financially independent from men. So the pill has been really amazing in terms of being a force in women's lives. And because of this, questioning or thinking critical about the birth control pill can scare people, making them think that they'll have to go back to a time when women were financially dependent on men or lose our freedom feels scary. The second rule that we violate when we start asking questions about the birth control pill is that we are oftentimes told that we cannot talk about women's sex hormones being involved in what the brain does. And the reason for this is that for a very long time, women were treated as overly emotional, less rational versions of men because of our changing sex hormones. There's been a lot of sexist rhetoric floating around throughout the ages saying that women shouldn't be able to hold important jobs, own land, or vote because our cyclically changing sex hormones made us completely irrational, and therefore not somebody that we should trust in those types of situations. But being unwilling to grapple with the fact that our sex hormones matter and that they're a part of what makes us who we are prevents us from being able to have thoughtful discussions about the pill. Because the fact of the matter is, whether we like it or not, our sex hormones do matter and they're a part of what makes us who we are. But contrary to what you might think, there is nothing about this idea that is dangerous to women. To start with, although it is true that women's hormones change cyclically, they're not unpredictable. They're not capricious or whimsical or fickle the way that it has been argued. If you tell me a woman's age and the first day of her last menstrual cycle, I'll be able to tell you with an almost alarming amount of precision exactly what her sex hormones are doing at that moment. If she is in the first half of her menstrual cycle, we will see that the sex hormone estrogen is relatively high relative to levels of progesterone. And if it is the second half of her cycle, I can predict that progesterone levels are going to be relatively high relative to levels of estrogen. So even though women's hormones change cyclically, they're not unpredictable and they're not capricious. Men's primary sex hormone, testosterone, on the other hand, is a totally different story. We know from research that men's testosterone levels change in response to just about everything. They change in response to age, they change in response to the time of day, they change when a man gets married and when he has children, they change depending on whether or not he has just watched sports or whether his favorite political candidate has won or lost, and it even changes in response to seeing weapons. So if anybody's got capricious and whimsical hormones, it's men. So the idea that our hormones influence our brain and the idea that they change, these aren't things that are problematic. Women's hormones change and they influence women's behavior and how they think, feel, and what they do, but so do men's. And we need to be able to start having conversations about these things because not doing so is bad for women's health. We need to break the rules that have prevented us from having thoughtful conversations about the birth control pill and who it makes women. Because even though women take birth control for a small number of targeted effects, the impact it has on women are anything but targeted. The way that the birth control pill works is by changing women's levels of sex hormones. And even though we tend to think of our sex hormones as something that happens to us, like something that causes puberty or hair growth in places we don't like to talk about in polite company, our hormones aren't something that happened to us. They are a part of us. They are a key part of the signaling machinery that our brain uses to create the experience of being the person that we are. And so when we change women's sex hormones, which is what we do with the birth control pill, we're actually changing the version of a woman's brain that she creates. We change who a woman is. And there's a growing body of research in psychology and neuroscience that shows this to be true. For example, just thinking about sexual functioning, which is something that we all think a lot about, research finds that women on the birth control pill exhibit decreased sexual desire and decreased sexual functioning relative to what is seen in their naturally cycling peers. And the reason for this has everything to do with the hormonal profile that is created by the birth control pill. The hormones that facilitate the sexual response in women and sexual desire are levels of estrogen and testosterone. And when estrogen and testosterone are high, this is facilitative of sexual desire. And when levels of progesterone are low, this is something that's also facilitative of sexual desire in women. Progesterone actually inhibits women's sexual desire. The sex hormone profile on the birth control pill is actually anti-sex. It creates a hormonal milieu that's characterized by high levels of progesterone and low levels of estrogen and testosterone. And this is the reason that many women who are using hormonal birth control tend to exhibit lower libido. And it's not just sexual desire that can change in response to the birth control pill. It can also change who women are attracted to, because this is something that is also influenced by women's levels of sex hormones. For example, we know now from decades of research that women's own levels of estrogen predict the amount of testosterone that they tend to prefer in their partners. In other words, the sex hormone estrogen increases women's attunement to cues that have historically been related to testosterone levels in men. The graph you're looking at here is showing how women's own levels of estrogen predict testosterone preference in men's faces. As you can see, estrogen loves testosterone. Women, when they have relatively high levels of estrogen, are cued into facial cues associated with masculinity. And this changes their preference over the course of a natural menstrual cycle. When estrogen is high, their preference for these cues is high. And when estrogen is low, the preference for these cues is relatively low. Now, given that the birth control pill keeps levels of estrogen very low, we can make the prediction that women who are using the birth control pill should exhibit a diminished preference for testosterone markers in the faces of men. And that's exactly what the research finds. Women who are using hormonal birth control tend to prefer partners with less masculinized male faces than do their naturally cycling peers. And this is something that is found both when women are identifying men that they would like to have as short-term sexual partners, and also the people that women would like to have as long-term romantic partners. The research has also found that pill-taking women are actually choosing partners with less masculinized male faces relative to those chosen by naturally cycling women. For example, in one study, researchers had men come into the lab, and half of these men were chosen as partners by women who were using hormonal birth control, and the other half were chosen by women who were naturally cycling. And the researchers took photographs of the men's faces, created facial composites, and then had the facial composites scored for testosterone markers. What the researchers found was that the pill-taking women indeed chose partners with fewer testosterone markers in their faces. So the birth control pill might literally be changing the face of women's mate preferences. And it's not just sex and sex-related things that get changed on the pill. This is because our sex hormones influence a ton of different systems in the body. This includes our other hormone systems. This even includes the stress response, which, bad relationships aside, isn't something that most of us think has anything to do with sex. So stress, let's talk about that. Stress is something that most of us are far too familiar with. It's something that we experience when we're sitting in traffic, when we're giving a speech, or when we have too many deadlines at work. Anytime we're encountering a stressor, no matter what it is, whether you're giving an important presentation or you find yourself on the business end of a wildebeest stampede, generally within about 5 minutes of the stressful thing happening, our body will start to release the stress hormone cortisol. And cortisol is a hormone that gets kind of a bad rap because everybody associates it with stress, and this is true. But cortisol isn't what causes stress. Life is what causes stress. Cortisol is actually part of the solution. It is part of the way that our body helps us cope with and learn from stress. It dumps fat and sugar into the bloodstream so we can make a fast getaway if we need to. It primes our brain for learning and memory, so that way if we encounter a similar situation in the future, we'll be able to better deal with it. And because of this, when we are feeling stressed out, our body releases cortisol. Well, that's what your body does unless you've suffered trauma, have PTSD, or, as chance would have it, are on the birth control pill. Turns out that there's several decades of research now that show that women who are on the birth control pill exhibit a blunted or altogether absent cortisol response to stress. And this is something that's potentially really important. Not only because this is the sort of stress profile that we tend to see in people who've undergone trauma or have PTSD, but it's also important because it suggests that there might be structural changes in the brain that can decrease people's ability to cope with stress, cause problems with emotional regulation, and impair learning and memory. And there's research that suggests that these changes may be present in women using hormonal birth control. Not only do we see that birth control pills can predict an increased risk of developing anxiety and depression, there is evidence that finds that taking birth control pills during the teenage years, when the brain is still developing, this may influence women's risk of developing major depressive disorder throughout their lifetime, even after they go off of it. So you might be asking yourself, is this just the pill that does all of these things? Or is this the result of any form of hormonal birth control, including things like the implant, the shot, the vaginal ring, and everybody's favorite, the hormonal IUD? Sadly, It's all forms of hormonal birth control that can have these effects. Anything that inhibits ovulation with the release of synthetic progesterone, called the progestin, can have these effects. And this includes the hormonal IUD, which doctors sometimes tell their patients are hormones that act locally. But this simply isn't true because there is no such thing as a locally acting hormone. Hormones get into the bloodstream and go everywhere that blood travels, and this includes the brain. This is why most women do not ovulate when they are on the hormonal IUD, at least for the first couple of years. Their brain has shut off ovulation and hormone production in response to the hormones it releases. This is when women who are using the hormonal IUD experience the strongest side effects. And it's only once women begin to ovulate again and start producing their own hormones that women start to feel like themselves again. And unfortunately, because women are the ones who suffered the steepest consequences in the case of an unexpected pregnancy, hormonal birth control for men is harder to sell. Because they are less motivated to avoid an unexpected pregnancy than women are, it makes them less willing to tolerate all side effects. So although research is in the works to find a hormonal solution for birth control that is given to men, they're less likely to want to use it. And it's not just individual women who are changed by the birth control pill or the hormonal IUD or whatever form of hormonal contraception you're on. Each woman lives in an independent web that includes her friends, her family members, her romantic partners, and her colleagues. And so when we change what women's sex hormones are doing, these changes are going to echo throughout women's bodies in ways that have a lot of effects on her system. And they're also going to echo throughout the world as women are interacting with other people and changing the face of the world. So it's time to throw out the old rules. We need to start having more, not fewer, conversations about women's brains and the birth control pill. And this doesn't mean that we abandon the birth control pill. It's still going to be the best choice for a lot of women at certain points in their lives. It was my choice for over a decade, and this isn't one that I regret. And although there's some decent non-hormonal alternatives available, I for one like the copper IUD, there aren't nearly enough options. So we need to learn who we become on the birth control pill and push for more non-hormonal options. Women shouldn't have to change who they are to prevent an unwanted pregnancy. And they should be given enough information about what they put into their bodies to understand that this is exactly what they're doing when they're on the birth control pill. I hope you enjoyed the episode. To learn more, my book, This Is Your Brain on Birth Control, is available everywhere books are sold. You can also find me on social at Sarah E. Hill, PhD, and that's Sarah with an H. You can also find me online at sarahehill.com. Thanks for watching.